BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Backstage. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest. Tonight we have two wonderful theater groups from this immediate area talking about their upcoming productions, and I'm sure if you get out to see them, you will really have a wonderful time. A bunch of very talented people working very hard to bring you some fine entertainment. So let's get started with this. Tonight, we're starting with the Reading Civic Theatre and their upcoming production of Disney's Camp Rock, the musical. And with me tonight to talk about that, to my left is Jeanette D'Angelo. Welcome.
Thanks for having us, Dave.
And you're welcome. And sitting next to Jeanette is Angela D'Angelo. Welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Seated next to her is Jocelyn Shank. Welcome.
Thank you.
And next to Jocelyn is Bridget Ottinger. Welcome.
Thank you.
Next to Bridget is Bailey Ammons. Welcome.
Thank you.
And next to Bailey is Amanda Rivera. Welcome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And last but certainly not least, Carly Patton. Welcome to Backstage.
Yeah.
Okay. Some of these folks are familiar and some are new to the program, so I expect that you'll have a wonderful time finding out about them and the upcoming production. First, Jeanette, tell us a little bit about where and when Camp Rock the musical is going to be produced.
Okay, Camp Rock is going to be produced at the Miller Center of the Arts on the RAC campus, and we will be opening on Friday, September 16th at 7:30, then again on Saturday evening at 7:30, and on Sunday at 3 o'clock. There'll be a matinee.
Okay. And where can they go for tickets on that?
They actually can get their tickets by calling the Miller Center box office, and then they'll take care of everything.
Okay. All right. And as you can see, the flyer up there, you can get the number from that. Okay. Jeanette, tell us a little bit about Disney's Camp Rock the musical. Give us a synopsis, please.
Well, it's fairly easy to describe because it's about two camps. There's Camp Rock, two summer camps. There's Camp Rock, and then there was an offshoot of Camp Rock called Camp Star. That offshoot is a wealthier camp, and it took many people that were attending Camp Rock, it took them away from Camp Rock. And so there's a rivalry that begins between the two camps. They both share a passion for the arts. However, Camp Rock is the poorer camp. Camp Star, the offshoot, is a rather wealthy camp. And so there begins that competition. And throughout the show, you see how the Camp Rock kids come together, they pull together, because even though Camp Star is rather wealthy, they have the heart and soul. So it's a great show. It has a great message. And I think the misperception for this particular show is that it's about kids. Only kids are in the show, and that's not true. Unlike Les Mis last year, mm-hmm. which was a school edition and had to be performed by only students up to and including the age of 18, this is not that kind of show. It's a show. We do have mostly a younger cast because it's a summer camp. But we do have three adults in the show. It was open to adults as well. We have Brown, who's played by Stefan Stankiewicz. He's the owner of Camp Rock. And then we have Axel, and he's played by Tom Cody, and he's the owner of Camp Star. And then we have another woman who plays Georgina, who's like the commentator for the actual competition. And so, you know, it's not just a children's show. It's far from that. It's a family mm-hmm. show, and they're doing a great job. I'm really proud of mm-hmm. them.
So this is a musical, and they really get to let it all out in that.
It's not only vocally demanding and acting demanding. It's also, well, it's heavy dance, mm-hmm. heavy dance. Unlike last year, where Les Mis was vocally demanding, this one is dance heavy. So they're really getting an opportunity to experience hip hop. And I hope that the experience helps them in future theatrical mm-hmm. endeavors, because Angela's working them really hard, but they're really doing a great job. Mm-hmm.
And that's a beautiful segue into speaking with Angela and finding out a little bit about her and what you're doing in the show, your choreography.
Yep, okay. I'm choreographing.
Mm-hmm. And tell us a little bit about the choreography for the show, what they have to do and how they're rehearsing and mm-hmm. all that.
Well, like my mom mentioned, it's very hip-hop heavy, which is fun because I've never choreographed a hip-hop show before. And I gave them a huge taste of what was to come at the audition. I didn't really hold anything back. I made it really hard. I'm an educator, and I don't believe in just choreographing for them to just learn. For the time being, I believe in educating them for further endeavors to, you know, for their future growth if they're mm-hmm. going to pursue musical theater. So I'm really all about challenging them and teaching them as they go along. And I definitely think that they've made huge strides and great progress as dancers. Like I said, the majority of it's hip hop. There is one number called Heart and Soul that I gave an ode to like the 50s. Mm-hmm. Yeah, some Elvis moves in there and some like hand drive and partner dancing. And then there's a couple like musical theater moves, you know, everyone loves a good jazz square, but for the most part, it's really high-tech hip-hop and funky street kind of dancing. Bailey over here and his like co-partner Jordan, they do tricks and like flips and stuff like that. So it's mm-hmm. definitely exciting to watch. There's seven heavy dance numbers, and they're all different. There's jump roping in one. There's there's lots of different stuff. So I definitely would come out just to see how amazing these kids are at some pretty challenging choreography.
I think that's wonderful of what you're doing with the choreography and really teaching them more than just the moves. What prompted you to work that way? You said you're an educator.
Yeah.
And is that why you have that philosophy?
Yeah. I mean, I think for me, I've pursued musical theater in college, or Muhlenberg College had just the theater program, and it's really important to grow at a young age because that's going to make your foundation for the future, and not just a base of like dance terms, but being pushed in any capacity is going to make you grow as a human. It's going to challenge you, take you to new levels, and I think that's really important for the youth to experience at a very young age.
And I can imagine that the confidence they build, especially if they don't know how to dance or don't feel that they can dance, the confidence they get after working on this is really good.
Yeah, and I think there's something to be said, too. There are some people that have a really bad opinion or a bad stigma about children's theater, and my mom said this is not a children's theater production, it's an actual production with adults and things, but I never would want them to think, oh, I'm in a kid's show and I'm just going to step, touch, and jazz square the entire time. This is not kid-level choreography. I've taught them college-level material, and I think that they should be proud of the work they've done, and I think people should view this show with a different opinion and light than they might have previously thought about it.
Very good. Well, we found out a little bit about the background of the show and how it's being treated as far as choreography and all. Let's find out a little bit about those who are in the cast. Now, this is only a sampling of the folks in the cast. How many are there?
I believe there's either 29 or 30.
That's a good-sized mm-hmm. cast. Mm-hmm. That is a good-sized cast. We have about five of them. good. My math is still good. I can count there. let's start with Jocelyn. And Jocelyn, tell us who you portray in the show.
I play Michi Torres, and she's kind of like, I would say, the leader of Camp Rock. And she's trying to save it from being taken over by Camp Star at the camp across the lake. And throughout it, in the this is her second year at Camp Rock, and she kind of had a thing with Shane Gray, who is the lead singer of Connect Three, and like it's kind of based off the Jonas Brothers. And they come back to camp the next year, and they start to get to know each other better, and they like each other a lot. So
a little bit of everything in
yeah.
for that. Now, you have something in common with her, because this is your second year with the shows, with the summer theater, summer musicals?
Mm-hmm. Okay. I was in Les Mis last year.
Okay. And you play what role?
I was a poor person, and then I was a wedding dancer.
Very good. And how have you taken to the dancing? Have you always liked dancing, or has this been something that's new to you, or what?
Well, I kind of struggle on the dancing side, but Angela's helped me a lot, and most of my cast, actually everyone in our cast, with the dancing. And I feel like by doing this show, I was like, it's really dance heavy. I'm not sure I can do it, but practicing over and over again, I find myself to be a stronger dancer now than I was before.
Good, good. Okay, Bridget. Let's find out a little bit about you. Who do you play in the show?
I play Peggy. She is like a loyal Camp Rocker. This is her like second year, and she's best friend with Ella, who Carly is playing, and she won Final Jam the last year.
Very good. Okay, now you also were in Les Mis?
Yes.
Who did you play?
I played Little Cosette.
Okay. What do you find different between working on Les Mis and this show?
Definitely the dancing.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, there was a lot here and almost none there. Do you like that more?
Yeah, I do.
Oh, good, good. And you, you're the youngest cast member, I believe.
Yes, I am.
Ah. Well, how do you get along with everyone in there, and how do they feel, you know, how do you fit in?
It's basically just the same if I was like any age,
because mm-hmm.
I feel in theater everyone's accepted.
That's good, good. Okay, if you'll hand the microphone over there, Bailey, tell us a little bit about your role in the show.
Well, I'm Baron. I'm the hip-hop dancer in the group. I'm just like them. This is probably my second year at Camp Rock. He can't stand still. He always has to dance. And he's just a really goofy character, and he's so much fun to be.
Good. You're coming from a little bit of a distance here. You're in the Schuylkill Valley District, right?
Yes.
Okay. How's the, well, it's summer, and it's easier to get back and forth at this time. Do you do shows during the school year that you might have to travel like this, or are you doing shows closer to home?
Sometimes I do shows out of the area. Sometimes I do them in Ephrata.
Okay.
Most of the time I do them close here.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now it was said earlier that you're doing the hip-hop and you're really doing some flips, and all. Tell us a little bit about your choreography.
So it's a whole lot of jumping. It's really fast-paced. It's a lot of energy. Like, I'm jumping over my co-partner in a lot of it, and he's jumping over me. And it's just an all-around great time. And whenever we're not dancing, we're still dancing.
Now, I hope you've been a dancer all along, and this is, you know, coming in. Or is this a start for you in dancing?
I haven't been the best dancer, but Angela's taught me a lot. I had private lessons with her for a little, and she helped me out so much. She's been such a great help.
Good.
Aww. Thank you,
Okay, Amanda, if you'll take the microphone, And tell us a little bit about your role in the show.
So I play Rosie, and basically she's the new girl at camp. This is her very first time. Everything is very new and exciting to her. She's very eager to make new friends. She's very eager to fit in. She's very eager to jump right into making music and being who she is as an artist. And she's very, very excited to be at Camp Rock.
So. Okay. Now, you were in other shows
I did not do Les Mis, but the year before that they put on Shrek the Musical.
Okay.
And I was in that. I was the Shoemaker's Elf / mm-hmm. Duloc Dancer / Duloc Guard, right? That was so long ago. Yes. And that was a blast. It was my first community production, and it totally opened my world to more than just high school production. It was a very different environment. It was a very different, you know, setting, and it was a lot better than a high school production. I'm not gonna lie. It was a lot more fun.
You have different people who specialize in different things, and in that, so it's all good and all interesting, mm-hmm. and you learn a lot from working with a lot of different people like that. Now, you are the oldest in the cast as far as the
kids? Campers. Yes, yeah. I'm not yeah. oh, the I oldest didn't, yeah. person. Mm-hmm.
My math hasn't gotten that bad. Sometimes my bank says otherwise, but hey. What has it felt for you? Like, do you feel like you might be one of those that helps chaperone type of help the younger ones along with, you know, give them some advice from your experience and all?
Yes and no, because I feel that while I am the oldest in the group, I'm kind of lumped into all of the other older kids. So, like, mm-hmm. I'm 19, but then we go down to, like, 17 and 16. So, like, mm-hmm. us as a collective, like, young adult group kind of chaperone, and mm-hmm. we are good role models as a collective group. It's not just, like, me by myself.
Okay.
It's everybody.
So. Okay. Carly, tell us a little bit about your role in the show.
So Ella is the fashion designer, and she always has to have that sense of like fitting in with her own sort of trends and things, and she doesn't really care what other people think about her. But then she has like her best friend Peggy, and no matter what, they're always together, and like they're always updating their statuses on social media, and they always want to make sure that they're still, even though they're basically at a summer camp for the whole summer, they're still involved with the outside world. And she actually gets to make costumes for the final jam production, and even though there's some challenges in that, she has a lot of fun with all of her friends.
Good. You're from Exeter High School?
I'm at the Exeter, junior high, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And now you were also in Les Mis?
I was, yes.
Okay, and you played
who? I was in the younger group, so I was a peasant, and I was with Jocelyn for most of the time.
Okay. Now, there's a lot of interesting things going on with this. Such as Bailey, this is your third one, third show with them? Okay. What's it been like for you with the continuity of going from in the past 3 years of working together? Are you seeing a lot of familiar faces, new faces? Tell us a little bit about your experience.
From Shrek to Les Mis, there were so many new faces because it was such a bigger cast. And then from Les Mis to Camp Rock now, I see a couple familiar faces along with a couple new faces. And it's always great when you see new and old faces because mm-hmm. you get to make new friends and you get to keep the old ones that you had.
Good, good. Keep in touch and find out. This can go to anyone that wants to. What's it been like for you to work on these particular productions in the summer with Reading Civic Theatre? Anyway, don't all jump at one. I know. Now I've worked with them in the past, and it's a wonderful group. They're very supportive. They're of everyone. But what has been some of your experiences, and maybe some of the highlights of it with working together or working with some of the newer people? And you can just jump in on that.
I think it's a really good experience because I feel like the Civic Theatre has a really good balance within them. I feel like not only can we have fun and can we goof off and just be ourselves, but we also get down to work and we put on a very good production, because while we do have fun, we also really get down to like elbow grease work, and we're working hard for long hours, for long stretches of time. Sometimes we don't get a break, but okay. But it's a very good balance that they have there. So.
And you're enjoying that, you know. What's it like for you to keep working on these shows now, year after year, for some of you? What have been some interesting things that have happened to you, you know, or in with some of your fellow actors and all, in doing the scenes, or anything that might stick out about the acting experience? Like you mentioned about a lot of hard work in there, but it's a lot of fun. Anyone else either feel that way or have anything to add along that line? Feel free to just go.
Well, I think with like being open about it, like theater has such an impact on your personal life, because when I was young, I wasn't shy, but yet like I didn't know how to express myself fully in front of a big group of people. And in theater, you have all of your friends who have that same passion, and then you can really basically public speak, but you can do it in dance or singing or acting, and it really helps you in the world as you grow older. So I think how we're young doing it, I think that'll help us so much more once we get older, because I started theater when I was 8, and I can't even imagine how much I've grown since when I started till now, and I can't wait to do more. So
up till now, what do you think has been the biggest thing you've gained from it, learned from it, or took away from the theater experience?
I think just making that solid group of friends, because no matter what your personality is or no matter how old you are, you're always accepted, and you can always go back to that group of friends in more shows. Like, I've done shows with Jocelyn and Bridget and Bailey. I'm new with Amanda this year, but I'm sure we'll do more shows together. So that's really one big thing that you can learn at a theater.
Anybody else have things they want to share about their experiences and what they've gained from working in theater, especially in musical theater?
I think we can all agree with this. It hasn't gotten any cooler in the rehearsal hall for any of the years.
Well, look at it this way. It's a free sauna. Yeah.
Everyone's 10 pounds skinnier than they were when they started.
But they never complain. I mean, they're amazing. They never complain. They just go about their business and they do what they need to do. And that's all we can ask. Thank God they're young.
Yeah.
But I'd like to say something. I mean, I've watched all of these 5 young people grow. But for Bailey, we've had him for 3 years. And his first year in Shrek, he was just really shy and, you know, didn't talk much. And then last year, I saw him grow. Within just that year, and he's very creative. And then this year when he came into audition and he sang, my mouth literally hung open, because I said, where did that voice come from? Not that he didn't have a good voice before, but it does my heart good as the educator that I am, and you know how I feel about the talent in Berks, the kids in Berks County.
Oh, definitely. With
it does my heart really good to see that he's grown so much, and he's only a junior.
sophomore.
Oh my God. See what I mean?
Oh yes.
So it makes me feel really good because I feel like, and I'm not patting myself on the back by any stretch of the imagination, but this is what I like and this is why I do it, because I see his growth. And I'd like to think that Reading Civic Theatre, myself and Angela and the rest of my staff have had a hand in it. But kudos to him, because he's doing his high school theater, he's doing other local theater, and that's the only way you're going to continue to grow. And that's why my mouth hung open. Because I thought, where did this kid's voice come from? And you know, that's why you must continue to do theater if you really think that that's what you want to do. Take every opportunity that you can. Stay with us, of course. I love working with you all, but that's not, you know, reality too. I mean, you need to spread your wings, but I'm telling you, this is an amazing group. And I got to watch, you know, Bridget grow so much, because she was really tiny last year. I don't know if you remember, as young Cosette, she was smaller. And then this year when she auditioned, I was, oh my goodness, where did that voice come from? And Angela did not dumb the choreography down at all.
I can't imagine it. I know it.
At all.
Okay.
And this young 10-year-old gives every one of those older kids a run for their money.
She's the one that gets the lowest. I'm always like, yes, work.
Like, but, you know, and it was fun to watch Jocelyn and Carly grow within just a year. And Amanda, I'm sorry that we didn't have her back last year, but she was fabulous in Shrek. But she's grown so much. So that's what we want to see, guys. Thank you. Because you should all be saying, I've grown. In some capacity, I've grown, whether it's vocally, acting, or dance. You've all grown, and it's quite obvious to all of us.
And this is something I hope that will be a positive influence to you in your life, no matter what you do, whether you work in do theater just because you love doing theater and in the community, or whether you go and get a career, whether you go into teaching of theater and the arts, or anything. I think you'll find, you get that confidence of being able, well, I can do this, I can learn this. Jocelyn, you tell us about some of what you've gained from doing these shows.
Well, Les Mis, that was my first time being with RCT. I was in the chorus, and so like I was like, there's so many people that I didn't know, and just seeing the people who are older than me, and like they were such good role models, really made me want to come back, and I'd be like, I'm really excited to be in the show this year, and it's gonna be so much fun.
And I noticed when you came in, and this actually applies to everyone, the poise and confidence that you had, the comfort level that you had coming into a situation like this. Some of you have not been on the program, some of you have before, being in front of a camera doing a live program, you have that self, you're self-possessed in a good way, that you know who you are, what you are, and that you know, you're learning and you're growing from this. And it's really good to see. And I hope the people at home and everyone else gets the idea that the arts, whether it be in the community or in the schools or whatever, is really one of the great things about a person's development. It gives you that confidence. Sometimes forensics, such as public speaking and oral interpretation, all that. I'd done some of that in my college career. That helps to bring out that comfort level of being in front of people and not worrying about how things are going. You just go with it and all. Bridget, tell us a little bit about you and what you have thought about and have grown or along that line.
Well, I've been doing theater since I was 4, and I was really like really shy, like super shy. I wouldn't talk to anyone. But then like I started doing more shows, and I just, like, my confidence boosted a lot, and doing Les Mis, like, helped me even more, so, and it was just so much fun, and I loved it.
That's good. That's good. Well, we're coming close to the end of the time. Is there, I'll go backwards here. Coralie, do you have anything that you'd like to say as a closing thought for your experiences with this
show? With Camp Rock, you know, like Jeanette said, there's a point where there's a kids show, and we totally broke that point. You know, we all came into auditions worrying about the dances because at first we felt that we couldn't get it. But now that we're learning all of these new dances and we're building our voices even more that we could ever imagine, I think it's just grown so much on us, and we can't wait to bring it out to the world even more and maybe even do a career in it.
Amanda, how about you?
I'm sorry, what was the question?
I was focused
on what she was saying.
That's okay. One final thing about your experiences with working in theater and Camp Rock and all that.
I've just learned that to embrace all ages in one production, because I was so used to high school where you were either 15, you know, to 18. So there wasn't much of an age difference. You didn't get to work with different groups of people, and doing Shrek, you know, I was working with 8-year-olds up to, you know, I'm not going to mention how old, but who knows how old. And it's really humbling, I guess, to know that, like, there's so much other talent in the world, and it can start as old as, you know, 10 to, like, as old as it can get. And it's really great to work with different ages.
How about you, Bill?
I wish you wouldn't have taken it all. Theater is fun.
I guess that's a good way of putting it. Theater is probably the hardest work you'll ever have fun doing.
Yeah.
No. Or dance or anything in the arts like that. How about you?
Well, I've learned that it's not just one person doing all the work. It's a team effort. Mm-hmm. And everyone has to put something into it.
So, yeah. Okay.
Jocelyn? Over the years that I've been doing theater, it's just all about teamwork. Everyone has to put their A game on. Everyone has to put as much work on, like, from the chorus to the leads. You all have to put the same amount of work in. Mm-hmm. And just to see that eventually come about when you're, like, putting on the production, it's just amazing.
I guess it's really, you really learn that we are all interdependent upon each other, that no one is a self-made person, no one is something, that we all really grow from working together, and we're as strong as we can be because we're all working at our best. Angela?
I just want to give a shout out to our musical director, Jared
Sure.
Miller, just because I feel like we spend so much time talking about the dancing, and it is really a dance-heavy show. But he's done amazing things with their vocals. And it may not be Les Mis hard with vocals, but he's made it seem hard in that he's really honed in their harmonies and their rhythm and their dynamics. And I think that the kids really enjoy working with him, and I really enjoy working with him. So kudos, Jared. We love you.
And Jeanette, any closing before I ask you to tell us where and when again?
Well, two things, and this piggybacks on everything that they've said, and, you know, not mentioning Jared was certainly not to...
I was just realized that we had...
But it is really a team effort, and the kids have heard me say that constantly. It's not just the director. It's not just the leads. It is the staff, and it is the cast, leads, and ensemble. You cannot do musical theater and walk into it saying, it's all about me. It has to be a team effort, and you have to go above and beyond. You have to want to do the best that you can and not settle. And now, having said that, the other thing that I wanted to say was, what's unique about this show is also this. We have four families that are in this show.
Wow, good.
And I remember working with Angela on shows, that it was always fun for her and I to work in a show together. And in this particular show, we have the Stankiewiczes, we have the Schlegels, the Mannixes, and the Coties. And there's nothing better and holds more precious memories than being able to be on stage with your kid. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't happen a lot. No. As a matter of fact, it doesn't happen or hardly ever. And so I just think that's another thing that makes this show so special. But, you know, they're doing a great job, and not once have I felt that it's been nothing but a team effort. They're working really, really hard.
Okay. Well, break a leg with the show. And before I leave, tell us one last time where and when Camp Rock the musical is going to be done.
Okay, it's Friday, September 16th at 7:30, Saturday, September 17th at 7:30, and Sunday, September 18th at 3 o'clock. And at the Miller Center for the Arts, and tickets can be purchased by calling their box office.
Okay. Well, I hope you folks get out there and support their efforts and support theater, live theater. It's just a fantastic experience for you, and it's all—it's always different because it's a different show each time. You don't have it down on film, so it can't be duplicated, and you'll find out how much fun it can really be. Well, we're going to take a quick break, and then we'll be back with Reading Community Players, and we'll find out about their upcoming production. We're Backstage. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest. You're watching us on Berks Community Television, BCTV.
Oktoberfest is BCTV's largest annual fundraiser. You can bid online or on the phone for 5 days live on a huge variety of items. Where do we get those items? From people like you. Would your business like to donate a gift card? Are you an artist who would like to contribute a piece of your work for auction? Do you have new, in-the-box items that you would like to donate to make a difference? Donations can be dropped off at our office or call us to arrange a pickup. Solo is a social, local, mobile app and website. Users can share what's going on around you. Reports are shared by BCTV on air and online, with the most recently shared reports positioned front page on our website. Assignments are created periodically to activate citizen coverage around Berks County. Capture events, report special moments, snap pics of scenery. Download free by searching Solo Berks in your App Store on Android and Apple.
And welcome back to Backstage. I'm your host, David Edgar Guest, and we just had a great time with Reading Civic Theatre, and now we're going to go to another Reading Theatre, Reading Community Players. They're not far away from us here, and we're going to find out what their upcoming production is going to be. With me tonight, I have Margie Wold. Welcome back to Backstage.
Thank you.
Been a little while, but I'm glad to have you back.
It's good to be back.
Sitting next to Marge is Debbie Silas. Welcome.
Hi, Dave. Thank you.
You're welcome. And Ruth Martelli. Welcome back to Backstage, both of you.
Thank you, David, for allowing us to be here.
Oh, you're welcome. And now, those of you at home, we're going to find out about the upcoming production that Reading Community Players is doing, and it's called Art. Marge, tell us where and when Art is going to be produced, please.
It's over at the Freiberger Gallery at the Penn State Berks campus. It opens next Friday, the 26th. It runs Saturday and Sunday afternoon. The Friday and Saturday shows are at 7, and the Sunday show is at 3.
Okay, and they can get tickets at the door, or their reservations, or?
Tickets, yes. At the door.
Oh, okay, very good.
And tickets are $10, because this is a staged reading, as opposed to a full-blown performance.
Right.
Oh, okay. All right, well, let's, Marge, give us a synopsis of the show, please.
Basically, it's about three guys who have been really good friends for 15 years, and one of the friends goes out and buys a painting for a huge amount of money, and his friend is shocked. He had no idea that somebody he knew so well would do this, and it brings the friendship of the three people to a crisis point. And the show is very clever, it's very witty, it's been compared to like a Seinfeld type comedy, and it just really shows the importance of friendship and what people will do to maintain a friendship that they think is worth it. Mm-hmm. I think that's pretty good.
I think the other thing that's really remarkable about the show is that it deals with the whole concept of what is art.
Yes.
Because there's some people who look at abstract art and go, oh my gosh, that's not art. And so that's part of the whole
right
conceit of the show as well. It's what do you consider art and what are you willing to pay for something that,
for something.
Yeah, exactly.
And it sounds like maybe what are the qualities that you look for in art, what are the values you see in the individual works, whether they be two or three dimensional, and all the colors or whatever.
Right. The painting that he buys is a white on white painting.
Ooh.
So that starts the whole conversation. And there is a touch of, just like art has different schools and different styles, people have different schools and different styles. And sometimes you have to make compromises to get along and to keep something that's important to you.
Sometimes I think you have to shut up and not say what, if you yes. If you buy a piece of jewelry or a piece of
yes.
art, sometimes I've got to behave myself and not criticize it, but rather allow you to express your preference and not make a judgment on it. And I think
sure.
that's where the one of the friends gets into trouble, because he is very judgmental. And I think he's the one who really brings the whole
yes,
relationship to the brink.
Right. Mm-hmm. There is some adult language in it. I do have to warn people. But
okay. Well, that's always good to know. But you anymore, you turn on the television or you
yeah.
go to.
You just never know.
Yeah, you don't know. Or just walking across the street, some of the language. Well, it is very colorful.
Yes, it is colorful.
Presidential rallies as well.
Yes.
Campaign rallies, I should say. Mm.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Why was this chosen and to be produced with, why did Reading Community Players do this? Was it something that you liked? Was something that you folks had seen and thought would be a good show to be done? And also, you're doing this in a
gallery.
Stage reading.
In our gallery.
Well, mm-hmm. I don't know if viewers realize this. Well, a lot of people don't think that we exist anymore. Everybody always says, oh, you're with Genesius. And while that's a lovely theater company, no, we're not. We're separate from. And mostly what Reading Community Players does, though we do do the occasional musical, is we do drama. Mm-hmm. There are some of us who can sing, and the rest of us couldn't get out of a paper bag if it depended on our voices. Last year, when we were thinking about a season, we turned to Bruce McLean, who suggested art, and we knew that Marge had directed it in the past, and we asked her if she would be interested in doing it again. The point I was trying to make before I got lost in my own rhetoric was that we no longer have a space. We decided to sell our building, which had been our home for, since 1960 on 11th Street, because it was a white elephant. It was just so costly to try to maintain the building. So we sold it. Then that begs the question, well, if you don't have a stage, where do you perform? And that, for anybody, and there are lots of theater companies in the area who don't have permanent homes, you go out and you look. Well, with art and the subject of painting being at the core of it, in addition to friendship and what have you, it made perfect sense to approach Marilyn Fox at the Freiberger Gallery to see if we could do this. Marge and I met with her, I think, way back in April, and she was very accommodating. She had ideas and what have you. And we did, a couple years ago, we did, what was the one with the 3-1 acts about death? I was in it.
Three viewings.
We did that one in a funeral home, mm-hmm. which made a whole lot of sense. If you're in a, if you're at a viewing, why not do it in a funeral home? So there is some rhyme and reason to what we're doing. Not always, but in this case, there was. And the fact that Marge said, yes, she'd do it was really wonderful because she's one of the member theaters in the consortium that we call the Greater Reading Alliance of Community Theaters. So it's an example of us working together in a really positive way.
And what you're doing actually is just telling a story, basically, is what theater is. It's done a little bit differently than maybe silently reading a book or having someone read to you or whatever. You're telling a story, and sometimes what better place to tell a story but in its proper setting?
Yes.
You can certainly build a funeral home representation or an art gallery representation on the stage. There have been so many things that have been put together on a stage that that can put it in. But you get a certain feeling when you're in the actual environment. What was it like for you folks, or what is it like for you folks to do this show in a more of a feeling of maybe the art gallery?
We really haven't been over there yet. We'll get over there next week. Mm-hmm. But it's not an action show. I mean, it's like I said, it's very similar to the Seinfeld type of comedy. So it's a lot of talking and it's a lot of funny repertoire between the people. And the three cast members that I have, Brian Miller and Brian Fichtorn and Kevin Wade, are just really have some chemistry, and it's fun to watch the rehearsals.
Good. I've seen and or worked with a number of them throughout the past, and it is fun and enjoyable to watch them or be with working with them.
Yeah.
And all. It's a bit about friendships, and we started talking a little bit about this earlier. Tell us about some of the ideas behind this theme of friendship. What kind of friendships are there? What different types of friendships are there with these people? Are they close? Are they because they like the same thing, or what? What's something about the characters themselves that draws them together and creates the friendship?
Well, one of them is a professional, I think.
Yes,
the man who buys the painting is actually a professional, not an artist or anything, but he has a sort of 9-to-5 professional sort of job. One of them is kind of lackluster, and he has kind of menial job, sort of a fry cook almost.
Right.
And the second one is he the one who's going to, somebody's going to get married, and he is in a tenuous position with his job and with his fiancé's family, I believe.
Yes, yes. That's the one that's like the fry cook person who...
And then the other one, the third character has a mediocre job, I think.
He's, right.
But he's the one who's the catalyst for all of the angst about the picture, because he insists on saying what he believes to be true. He makes himself an art critic, and it puts the man who's bought the painting on the defensive, and the third friend is left kind of as a mediator between the two. And it really does put pressure on all of them in different and strange and funny ways.
That's true, yes. It's, you know, anytime you have a three-way friendship, somebody is always kind of left out, and the one that's getting married is the one that's kind of pushed out, but he tries to keep getting them back together.
You have to come and see it to figure out whether it works.
I'm not telling the
ending. And see whether or not they find a way to reconcile it.
Right,
exactly.
Debbie, you have something about that's coming up with the Reading Community Players, or
yes, just to piggyback off of what Ruth said, we have heard from people in the area that people don't realize that Reading Community Players is still here. We are doing things at several different locations. We just finished doing our kids show, James and Giant Peach, at the Miller Center. And we do have two shows that are coming up this fall. One of them is called Death Defying Acts, and it will be performed at the Perkins Auditorium at Penn State. They are just refurbishing their auditorium, so that'll be the first thing that will be happening there. It runs December 2nd, 3rd, and 4th, but the auditions are coming up in September, and they will be at Christ Episcopal Church, September 25th and 26th. At 7:30. We are looking for two males and three females, and it is basically a composite of three one-acts. One is written by Woody Allen, and it's things that have to do with comedies that have to do with death.
Dark comedy.
Yeah.
But in addition to Woody Allen, his is called Central Park West, I think. One is called The Interview, and I believe that one is by David Mamet.
Yes.
And then the third is by Elaine May, and that's a telephone conversation that kind of plays off of the sorts of skits that she used to do with Mike Nichol.
Okay,
so
yeah.
It's funny, but when death is in the title, it's got to be a little bit dark.
Mm. Yeah, it almost also reminds me of Bob Newhart, who did a wonderful comedy routine on the phone. You said what, Miss?
We should point out that Bruce McLean is the director of that show.
Oh, okay.
And he has been a really venerable part of community theater in Berks County for a real, real long time. So he's looking for a few good men and a bunch of good women to cast the show. So do come out and audition for him.
Mm-hmm. And then we have our third annual holiday cabaret with our kids. Those auditions are going to be October 1st at 1 o'clock at Reading Civic Theatre Hall.
Oh.
Okay? And that is September 16th, 17th, and 18th. Mm-hmm. We aren't sure yet where we're doing it, so that's one of the things that we have to deal with.
Okay, well, you keep me informed of what's going on, and I'll get it out, and with my computer problems hopefully solved, things will get better for the production promotions.
Got it, yeah.
Now, you're also doing a show with another theater group
I
in the area.
Am.
And let's give them a quick shout-out.
Okay, I'm
going to
give them a quick shout-out. This is for First Street Players in Birdsboro. We are doing a production of The Birds. Mm-hmm. It is a drama that involves four people after the bird apocalypse of the movie of that name, Alfred Hitchcock's The Birds. It is September 16th and 17th. At 8 p.m. If you want tickets, you can call 610-404-8436 or email tickets@onestreetplayers.org. It is a very interesting drama.
Okay. And we've got a couple. I just want to give you a quick shout out to about Genesius Theater. They're doing Steam Bath coming up latter part of the month into the beginning of September, and Eroica, I blew it last month, I'll blow it again with their with the pronunciation of the name, but that's with Burke Sinfonietta, and that will be at Sacred Heart Roman Catholic Church in West Reading, and that's coming up on this weekend, August the 20th, Saturday, and it's 15 for adults and 5 for students, and you can get tickets there at the door. Thank you all very much for being on the program.
Thank you, Steve. It's always
not enough time.
Yep.
But thank you, and break a leg with the shows.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And those of you at home, please get out to see some of these wonderful productions that are right here, conveniently located, and very economical to come in and catch and see these theaters. Enjoy live theaters like nothing else you've ever experienced. Well, for Backstage, I'm your host, David Edgar, your guest, and we'll see you next month backstage. Take care.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.